and I'm not going to give you another chuck. That was a tough one. I was guessing for most of it. I mean, you're a dancing frog. Who knows how many dancing frogs? And what defines dance for a frog? I don't know. So, just a little bit of an introduction before we get into it. I'm the Reverend Dr. Terry Gallagher, a charity environmental task force for the Illinois Conference of the United Church of Christ. I'm a bit of a strange guy. I started out life originally as an engineer. I spent 32 years in the chemical industry as an engineer and as a plant manager of not one but two different chemical plants, very highly hazardous chemical plants, before I took this strange call in the ministry. So I started seminary when I was already gray hair and a lot less of it than when I started. And I pastored a couple of local churches in Downriver, Detroit for half a dozen years. I heard God call me, and I knew I was not yet done understanding what God would have to do. So I went on a series of immersion experiences so that I could listen to voices that I don't normally hear. Because if we only listen to the voices that we always hear, we never get the chance to hear new truths. Wrestle with things that we don't yet understand. And so I went to Palestine to be among the people who live with the threat of war every day of their life. And I went to Mexico to see what are the effects of our international trade. What does it cost so that we might have cheap TV? And I saw the shanty town where one shanty leans against the next one in order to support itself. And it was in a river gully that was dry most of the time, except when the flash floods would come and then, you know, get swamped. Then there were all those sewer pipes aiming out into this valley, coming out of the factories of the free traders that the people told me at night ran red, orange, purple, green down into their streets. Because they weren't officially there. There might have been 10,000 of them in the shantytown, but they were not officially there. And I went to Colombia as a part of the Christian peacemaker team. We were called to be in Colombia to be a presence between this village, this mining village up in the Andes, and the Colombian army that had set up outside in the jungle, right outside their village. And the villagers had asked us to be there to be a presence so that maybe the army wouldn't come and move them off their land. And they had a lot of reason to understand this because we do that. That's how we get bananas. We move people off their land in the middle of the night. In Colombia and a lot of Latin American countries and other places in the third world, land is not all that well documented. So it's really by who's occupying. And so if you hire an army or a paramilitary group to move off the buildings, then aha! The land's free! It's available! We can take it! Our corporation has confessed to us. But this wasn't us. This was a Canadian mining company. They had just been granted the rights by the Colombian government to mine. So the village was really, really concerned that the army had just come in. They're going to move them off this land. And so they called for an international peacekeeper team to be present there with the understanding that maybe if we were there with our eyes and our reporting capabilities, the army would hesitate to act. And so as part of this, they gave us a tour of how they did what they did. They were really artisan gold miners. They were mining dust. Kind of like we would have done back in the 1850s. It involved a lot of backbreaking work, you dig and dig and dig and dig, of lots of dirt that had a little dust of gold. and then you grind it with mercury, because there's a reaction and an attraction between mercury and gold dust that pulls the gold out of the dirt and clumps it around the dirt. And then you wash it. And then you take what's in your filter stuff and you burn it. You flare off, vaporize off the mercury and the other contaminants to get the gold. And my colleagues were just amazed at how ingenious these people were and how hard they worked to do what they did. Now, of course, because it's a hazardous chemical by man, I can see they can do it. But I was a visitor there. I was there to listen. I was there to be a presence. I was there to be a witness. I was not there tell them what to do. So I resolved to be quiet. Heck, I can't even speak Spanish. How am I going to tell them? And so we went out after the tour and met in the jungle with the Colombian army to express to them the concerns that the villagers had about their presence there. And my job was to watch the army snipers and camouflage in the jungle to see if they were going to shoot. Now what good that would do, I don't know, but they had to give me a job at that. You watch, if they're going to shoot, wave your hand. So we get back from that, and my colleagues who are fluent in Spanish, one of them was Pastor Dan Dale from Chicago, starts telling how the meeting went. What did the Army think about the concerns? And I'm sitting there saying, I'm going to what? I can't. So I stood up and asked for an interpreter. I said, I got really caught, but I can't stay silent. You gotta know that what you're doing is destroying this mountain for generations to come. You're poisoning the water and the soil and the air. You're destroying the brains of your children exposed to mercury. You're selling your soul. And it was absolutely quiet. And so I turned to Dan and I said, would you offer a word of prayer, a word of comfort for them, because I hurt them, I have violated this cultural boundary. He said, no, wait. They're processed. And after what seemed like forever, but it was really only a minute or two, the village president stands up and says, you know what? What he said is the truth that we all know. We just refused to follow. So the next night, they called a meeting of the entire village. Gathered together in the hall. They didn't have any other room to take them. So that I, a stranger in their midst, could tell them the truth that they already knew. They just refused to talk. So I come away from that experience saying, what are they are? Let's think about it. What are the chances that a Colombian village up in the Andes are going to call for a team of Christian peacemakers? And on that team is going to be a pastor that used to be a hazardous chemical plant manager. What's the odds? And no doubt. That's God at work in the world. That's the Spirit. So 7 years ago, that launched my ministry of ecological justice. Coming off of that, I left local ministry and I went back to seminary and got my doctorate so I could deepen my theology on how to speak the truth. And we already know. We just refuse to talk. Unless I put my hand in those wounds, stick my hand in that sock, I will not believe. Oh, Thomas. What's his name? Doubting Thomas. For 2,000 years, this poor guy is known as Doubting Thomas. This poor guy same thing that we do. Unless I see, unless I experience, unless my physical senses tells me and verifies me that a truth that I do not want to encounter is true, I will not believe it. We are way back when I was a little girl. I went to Catholic Church. And I remember a priest speaking on this and saying, "Blessed are you who believe without seeing." And he said, "We're, that's who we are. We're those who believe without seeing. We're blessed." Because I believe without seeing. Then I spent the next 60 years of my life wanting to see and to trust so that I might believe. So you can say that my immersion experiences around the globe, on this back of my earth, are the seed, the womb, and the body. Wounds that we inflict in the body of Christ. So was Thomas the only one that didn't get it? Or was he the only one that spoke up? Scripture tells us this is a repeat. The disciples and also Thomas were gathered in this room behind locked doors because they were scared, fearful, at what they had done to Jesus they were going to do to them. So they locked those doors. Keep those soldiers out. Let no one know where we are at. Because it's all over. It's all over. It ended on Calvary. He spoke good stuff. And we were so in love. But it ended. Women had reported back. They had seen Jesus. But they're women. Who's going to believe that? We need to stay in this room. They're going to do to us what they did to him. So they're gathered in this room behind locked doors. Jesus comes and says, "Peace be with you." And they all say, "Jesus, you're here. Oh Lord, are you good? Oh, thank God." And he breathes on them. He says, "Receive the Holy Spirit. Me, I send you." He comes back a week later, and what do they find? They're still in that upper room behind the locked door, scared. Maybe it was an illusion. Maybe that wasn't really Jesus. Thomas, come. You gotta come. You had to tell us that what we saw was real. I don't care what we saw until I touch on it. But Scripture doesn't say it's got to be what was in Jesus' mind when he came back in that room. And what came into his mind when he came back in the room is this very simple question. What are you doing here? What are you doing here? What about last time did you not grasp? As my Father sent me, I send you. And you're sitting here. Tommy, you want to stick your hand in? Anybody else? What does it take? How many times do I have to breathe before you catch me? Before you're brave enough to unbar those doors and go out
into the world and show the world how to love.
To leave that upper room, to be the presence of Jesus in a world that is filled with denial. How many times does he have to breathe? Right now, we are in the greatest crisis that human civilization has ever witnessed and will ever witness. If we don't resolve this crisis, there will not be human civilization. It's that simple.
Amen.
And all
Amen.
We're doing is hurl. All we're going to do is crank up the air a little bit. I'll be all right. We can build the dams up a little higher. We'll be all right. We might have to pay a little more food as the drugs go across, but we'll be all right. People are starving right now. They're not human anymore. They're not. 18 months ago, after 22 meetings, 196 countries across the globe come together and say the climate crisis is real, it's human caused, it's happening now, and our response to be with urgency, because if we don't turn away from it, there will not be human civilization. What do you not understand? I haven't told you. I haven't stuck my hand in your side. My kids are still eating. My house is still under water. We've got time. There's still money to be made. Why would we want to change what we do? There's still money to be made. Besides, somebody said there's still questions. And because somebody said there's still questions, that we don't have to engage. We'll wait until they actually come to an answer. 196 countries came to the decision. What do we do? I was in Honduras in December. We had gone up into the mountains, something about mountains, and then down into the valley. And we met with this indigenous tribe who were protecting this land that they had owned since, well, claimed since the dawn of time. And a corporation was trying to build a dam across their holy river, which would destroy their sacred land. And so they had drawn a line across this road, this small little mountain road, and said, you will not cross that. We will pay you with our bond if necessary. You will not destroy our holy rivers. Destroy. And so paid with their lives, they did. Their leader, a brave woman by, oh Lord, I just don't bring it on names. Her last whisper, boy, I hate being at the safe by losing it. Anyway, the year before, actually 8 months before, in the middle of the night, 5 assassins came in the row to slaughter. Her. 5 assassins to slaughter one woman because she dared to speak. How dare you speak? And so we had gone to meet with her indigenous tribe, and four different leaders spoke up. There was a woman elder, and a man elder, and a male leader, and then a young woman. And they were all talking about just how much the sacred trust had between the river and the land was. It was a young woman that really got me, because she said she had survived this machete attack. But that wasn't going to stop. She was going to stay there to protect that whole room and the sacred. So I was asked to offer a few words. And I told them, there's an old story that really resonates with me. Yeah. In the Middle Ages, a group of rabbis were arguing over a piece of scripture and trying to discern what the truth was in that scripture. And that's what they often do. They get together and they argue. And finally, out of it, they discern a new understanding of scripture. And the scripture they were arguing about was Moses and the burning bush. You remember that story, right? Moses and the burning bush. Moses comes across the burning bush. But what they were particularly arguing about, because they get down to the little bitty gritty, is why was it necessary that that bush burn and yet not be consumed? Why was it necessary that the bush be on fire and yet not be consumed? And the answer they came to after days and days of arguing was this. We don't know. The scripture doesn't tell us how many times Moses passed that burning bush before he noticed it. How many times he walked past that bush before he paused to look and say, what's going on? And in that pause, he heard the voice of God say, take off your shoes, you're on holy ground. I told him, in our 21st century, in our modern civilization, their presence, willing to die for that river or that land, is a burning bush. And we needed them to keep on burning until we woke up enough to pause and say, what's going on? And in that moment, allow ourselves to hear God say, take off your shoe. You are destroyed by creation. Show some respect. Here's the thing. You need to become a great one. Every one of our faith communities needs to become a burning bush. You need to become passionate about the future of your children, of your grandchildren. You need to overcome this shyness that we will not speak about this because somebody might get upset. It's our grandkids' lives. Let them be upset. The call of the church in 2017 is exactly the same as the call of the church in 1840. The church has to rise up and say, take off your shoes. All creation
unbelievable.